Our praise God are going to bring us into worship. In fact, just give them a round of applause. They're packed so hard. Just a little housekeeping up. In case there's fire, I know you're going to say bring on the fire. But the fire escape's back where you came from, or shoot out the door and keep going. Okay? And that's just in case there's an emergency. I'm going to let Steve do the introductions tonight just a little bit later. But I want us to stand, we're going to pray, and do some worship again. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just ask you to take control. Lord, we give you control of our building, of our meeting. Lord, Lord, we just ask that you would be the center of our praise and our worship tonight. I pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit just comes into this building and soaks it. Comes down upon every person here gathered tonight. And Lord, we just ask that this part of Coleraine will be changed tonight forever. We pray for a reconciliation. We pray for a healing of the hearts and minds at this time, Lord. And I just thank you that you're dropping a pebble into our pool tonight, and the ripples will continue to go out from this night forward. And we ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
I'm just going to, it's a tradition in this church that I don't introduce the guests, especially if I don't, and I wasn't the one who brought them here, so I'm going to introduce Stephen first, and then Stephen's going to introduce our guest tonight. So I want us to give Stephen Carver's a friend of our church, and he's been doing some interesting things lately in his job, and has fallen to different parts of the world, and I'm going to let him introduce him on the way.
It's so good to have you here in Coleraine.
They can't see you!
That's the idea. Well, you hear somebody say to praise the Lord. We're so privileged to have you here in Coleraine, which is the last night of 3 days that you've spent in Northern Ireland, or Ulster as you formally call it. So, we're so privileged that you actually extended your stay to actually come and speak, especially here in Coleraine. So we're so
I'm so pleased that I extended my stay because your mother-in-law has made me some Ulster shortbread, which is the best in the world. Not her with normal Irish shortbread. That's it.
Better make a correction. My mother made the shortbread.
Your mother! I'm sorry! Thank your mother for me. She must be a great lady of God.
She's actually here, so we'll love her.
Is she here? Oh, thank you.
So we're called the slide test. So.
Hi! Oh, lovely to see you!
So, we're so privileged just to have you here. And I know that actually, on the way in, we got some really challenging news about a member of your staff. And, you know, it's.
You're literally on my way in.
Yeah.
Our people would burn up and kill. But you know all about that, Kim.
Yep.
You've been there. We've been there. We're in it together. You see, we're one family.
Yes.
And there aren't many people been through what our family.
Andrew, would you like to sort of share a little bit about your upbringing? Sort of help us to understand who Andrew White
is. Don't you want to tell them how we met?
Well, we could do that.
It was only a few weeks ago, wasn't it?
It was.
We were both lecturing on terrorism, weren't we?
We were.
Yeah, in Jerusalem.
We were. And you invited me out for dinner to a lovely cafe, if I remember.
Today's Cafe.
Yeah.
It's a posh restaurant in Israel called the King David Hotel. But it's next door to where we live, so we call it Dave's Cafe. We went to Dave's Cafe, didn't we?
And then the next day you actually took me to that way out.
Yeah.
So, that was really special. Thank you. Really did. Yeah. And actually, then I caught across our paths together, and we were very quickly, obviously, to get a connection in the spirit with each other.
Amen.
Amen. Even though we were there talking about a very different subject. So, it's very interesting. I was warned in the conference not to mention anything about Jesus. And then, when you get up, you very freely spoke about Jesus. And I was warned that I would be arrested if I did it.
Look, I've been in Jerusalem a long time, Jerusalem and Iraq, and I studied as a rabbi. I'm what we call in Yiddish a yeshiva. I went to the right yeshiva. rabbi this morning for breakfast, and he didn't go to the right yeshiva. He went to the wrong yeshiva. But he's right anyway. Harry, sorry about the interruption.
Absolutely. Totally. Good morning, here with you. So, what about your upbringing?
My upbringing. I'm not saved. I'm not converted. Because from a tiny little boy, my parents told me that Jesus loved me. And I never disagreed with them. I've always believed it. So the earliest thing I remember was that I loved Jesus and he loved me. I've always loved Jesus. I might be an Anglican canon. Any Anglican canons here? Well, there are two types of canons. There are big shots or loose cannon. I haven't learned yet what type I am. But I wasn't reared in Anglican. I was brought up two different ways. My mother was Pentecostal, and my father was ultra strict Baptist Calvinist.
No.
So I became an Anglican. Only way you could hold this together.
Wow. How has that relationship with Jesus, knowing him at such a young age, how has that shaped your character? Because you are a bit of a character.
Well, I've always loved Jesus. Even though I went off to Cambridge and did boring theology, I've always loved Jesus. I've never doubted. It's very strange not to have doubted. I started, when I was 10 at school, when I was a nice little boy, there were three children in our family, and I was considered the not very clever one. Andrew is very nice, but he's not very smart. So when my teacher asked me at 10, what do you want to do when you grow up? I said, I wanted to be an anaesthetist and a priest. She said, you're going to have problems. Because you can't do two things, you can only do one. And you're a Pentecostal and they don't have priests. So I grew up and left school and went off and did my medical training. And then trained to be a gas man. You know, gas men, like me, can either put you to sleep with drugs or boring sermons. And drugs were a lot quicker. So I became a gas man. And I went to an England church. How many Ealing people here? Some of us, anyway. So I went to an Ealing church because that was quite au fait with my history. You see, my grandfather was a bag carrier for a guy whose Bible. This is Smith Wigglesworth's Bible. It's his actual real Bible. There are his sermon notes in here, and his picture, and his letters. He was one of the
boundaries of the pink cross. So that's my Bible. I will let you look at it if you buy a book. So, I became a gas man, and I trained at a hospital in London called St. Thomas's, bang off the Houses of Parliament. And I loved my job so much. It was the best job in the world, resuscitating the dead. It's always a good thing being able to raise the dead. I recommend it. Quite a good trade. Anyway, one day I was thanking God for enabling me to be at the best hospital in the world. I'd forgotten about the thing of wanting to be a priest then, because I was so happy doing what I was doing. And I said, Lord, thank you so much that you have given me this incredible job to do. And then I remember, when you speak to God about things, you need to ask him what he wants you to be doing. So I said, Lord, thank you so much that I am here. What do you want me to do next? He said to me, I want you to go into the ministry. I said, but Lord, I'm good at what I do. What's wrong with what I'm doing now? He said, you've got to go into the ministry. He didn't just say that. He said, I want you to be Anglican. I said, Lord, do you realize that they're not even all saved? And he said to me, yes, I do. I do realize that. So, I bought it. You know, sometimes God tells you to do something and you don't want to, so you bite it. I bought it, but guess how long? Half an hour. That was long enough. I couldn't bite it any longer. And when I gave in, it was the most wonderful experience of my life. So I started my process towards selection for training for ordained Anglican ministry. It took 2 years, the selection process. And then I left St. Thomas's Hospital. It was quite funny because the very last day I was at St. Thomas's Hospital, I was caught busy working because the person who was running the crash team, who was supposed to be doing it, was actually sacked. So the day before I left, I was running to a cardiac arrest in the psychiatric day unit, and I remember it very clearly because they weren't used to having cardiac. And the matron of the hospital tried to help me with the anesthetic machine. And she got in the way, I was running with it. It smashed me in my face, broke my teeth, blood was pouring down my mouth. And I was going to Vicar Factory the next day as if I'd been beaten up. So that's how I stopped you. Thank you.
Wow. You mentioned Smith Wigglesworth.
Yeah.
He's a very interesting guy. And I
I didn't know him, actually.
Yeah.
My grandfather knew him, not me.
I think if you knew him, we'd probably be a lot grayer and bolder than they probably are. Right, before we were, I think, wasn't it? Do you think that that has any influence on you or your family?
Well, when my grandfather gave me Smith Wigglesworth's Bible 2 days before he died and told me he had worked